Okay, I was saying just thank you for your kind invitation. I'm very happy to be here today to talk with you about this topic of social and cultural issues of organ donation and transplantation. My institution is the Department of Health Sciences of the University of Magna Graecia in Catanzaro, in southern Italy, and I'm a medical sociologist with a PhD at the University College London. I'm currently full professor of general sociology. I was the founder and the first president of the Società Italiana di Sociologia della Salute and the president of the European Society of Health and Medical Sociology, and also vice president of the Research Committee 15 on Sociology of Health of the International Sociological Association. Currently, I am the coordinator of the board of the section of Sociologia della Salute e della Medicina of the Associazione Italiana di Sociologia. And also the coordinator of the board of the Research Network 16 of Sociology of Health and Illness of the European Sociological Association, and the director of an inter-university center called CRISA about active and healthy aging. The topic I'd like to discuss today with you is about the shortage of organs. As you know, it is a very debated topic. And usually, the way it is framed, it is that the demand for organ transplantation has rapidly increased all over the world. There is rising success and greater improvement in transplant and post-transplant outcomes, but the unavailability of adequate organs for transplantation to meet the existing demand has resulted in major organ shortage crisis. And as a result, a major increase in the number of transplant patient waiting list, as well as in the number of patients dying while still on the waiting list. This figure shows in the American context which are the kind of patient on the waiting list. In particular, as you can see, in the USA by 2020, there were 90,000, about 90,000, 95,000 patients of kidney waiting to receive transplant. In the other cases, the number of needed and received subjects are less numerous, as you can see. Some common procedures and solutions which are suggested to deal with problems usually are that by the implementation of appropriate educational programs for the public and the hospital staff regarding the need and the benefit of organ donation should be the best way of dealing with this matter. Also, as you know, recently the concept of presumed consent was accepted in order to increase the number of eligible donors. Also, the implementation of some system of reward gifting for the family of the deceased donor in case of problems, and also for the living donor himself or herself, or the development of an altruistic system of donation from a living donor to an unknown recipient is another way of dealing with this problem, and accepting also the concept of controlled system of financial payment for the donor is another strategy commonly used. The belief is that by the implementation of this pathway, of this strategy for obtaining organs from both the living and the dead donors, the organ shortage will be eliminated and many lives will be saved. Well, my question is whether we are really sure that this is the right way of framing these issues. Some assumption, usually undiscussed in the debate about the shortage of organs, in my opinion, should be raised and tackled in order to check whether there is another way of looking at the issue of shortage of organs. And in particular, I included four assumptions. As you can see, the first is that usually when we talk about voluntary donation, we assume that we are talking about autonomous individuals or very legal substitute, which makes a rational decision about donation or not as a rule for voluntary donation. And the second assertion is that making a diagnosis on brain death is straightforward and ought to be readily accepted as human death by everyone involved, including grieving families in particular. The third assumption is that organs are simply biological parts of the body, mechanical entities, whose worth is without symbolic and affective meaning that can be alienated. And finally, the fourth assumption is that the expector of the bought and sold body parts is nearly inescapable one in the realm of transplantation, as you remember, as you can usually see in mass media, in cinema, and also in the popular culture. Well, what I'll try to do is to discuss these four assumptions and the consequences of them. The usual consequences are that organs go to waste if they are not donated, and every citizen should be willing to contribute, therefore, to their organs for their utilitarian use in transplantation. And usually the idea is that the primary barriers to procuring more organs for transplantation are mainly three: lack of education, as you know, more educated people usually are more commonly donors. Irrational fears, like religious beliefs and superstition, against which science and science acceptance should be the main strategy. And lack of generosity in a society where individualism and lack of social ties is commonly seen as the rule. The further consequences of the situation is that there is a sense of entitlement from the point of view of potential recipient, especially middle-aged people and their close relatives, about shared expectation of a long life facilitated, if necessary, by medical intervention, such as organ transplantation, especially by living donation. Well, as I was saying, I will deal with each of these four assumptions and their consequences, trying to show that there is a possible different than our way of considering them by looking especially by a comparative approach to the finding of the ethnographic, anthropological, and sociological research all over the world. And the first assumption, about the voluntary donation by rational decision of autonomous individuals, you will discover that is not the rule all over the world, because in many cultures and societies, the individual is not an autonomous subject, but he or she is fully part of a network of social relationships, family relationship, kinship relationship, community relationship, ethnic group relationship. And sometimes he's also not the one who decides for himself or herself, especially when it is a young or even an adolescent. This web of social ties implies a set of culturally established moral position and felt obligation concerning appropriate behavior in various social circumstances, including the donation and receiving of organs. So we cannot exclude this context when we talk about the problem of organ donation and transplantation. This is the reason why an ideal voluntary donation by rational choice of an autonomous individual in this respect is out of place. And I will make a couple of examples from very far societies, one in Eastern Asia, Japan, and the other one in Latin America, Mexico. In the Japanese society, there is a finely developed traditional system of reciprocal gift giving, characteristic of Japanese social relationship, within which the idea of and altruistically donated organ with no expectation or even possibility of reciprocation is thought as incurring an unbearable debt. The idea of gift, of social gift, is something linking much more than simply monetary market exchange, for example, which is much more impersonal. Instead, gift is completely personal, and personal implies this kind of social relationship and social duties and obligations. In Mexico, there is still a big social role of the large extended families, which maintains a central role in the society, and also organ recipients there are most likely to be involved in ongoing intimate family relationship with their organ donators. Usually, organ transplant there and donation is a matter of the large family, especially when the organs move between parents, typically mothers and children. Second assumption about brain death. As you know, the brain death diagnosis was codified by the Harvard Medical School in 1968 as the clinical state of death in which a patient's brain has ceased to function, but heartbeat and respiration continues with the support of the artificial ventilator. But this is not something universally recognized, especially by the grieving families in most society, because, for example, the idea of these living cadavers, according to the medical approach, which are considered as such, because of irreversible loss of consciousness, raises a lot of public concern, especially about the wrong determination of death and premature burial. And moreover, there is a pressure of time that comes into play if organs are to be procured from the brain dead for transplantation, since most of the times this collides with the culturally informed expectation about appropriate intrafamiliar behavior towards their loved one, for example, in terms of prayers, of dressing, and so on. And finally, the death and this determination in most society is not just a medical matter. This is something which is a typical consequence of the development of medicine in Western modernity, in Western society. But differently, in most traditional society, where it was and often still is mostly, is considered as a religious matter managed by some kind of priest. Even in the Western society, as the older people can still remember, the death was not a matter of medical doctors until recently, but just a matter of calling the priest for the last prayer. Example about this in Japan, for example, brain death was not legally recognized until 1997, only after 30 years of virulent debates, and after that, even today, to be eligible to be a doctor, individual must be in possession of a bona fide donor card co-signed with a close family member, which stresses once again the importance of family ties. And most transplants continue to use organs from living related donors because it is still believed that a body that continues to breathe and have a heartbeat is not dead, because the person is not located entirely in the brain, but diffused throughout the body. And moreover, death has long been thought of as a social process, recognizable to a family member by very consensus, and not as simply an event of medical nature. In Mexico, the organ donation from brain dead donors is currently still rare, and vast transplant programs are largely dependent upon living donors, with the result that kidneys are the only solid organs routinely transplanted. low rates of cadaveric organ donation are due here to a popular Catholic interpretation of resurrection as requiring an intact body and also to believe in miracles as an ever-present possibility. And there is also a traditional distrust with some political implication in medical profession and the healthcare institution, which foster fears about inappropriate diagnosis of brain death and the potential profiteering from donated organs. The third assumption about the concept of the body, the act of taking organs from one person and putting them into another, evokes questions related to the conception of the body and indirectly to the self and the identity. And as you know, the practice of transplantation rests upon an objectified mechanistic vision of the body, typical of the West Cartesian split between body and mind, which make transplantation analogous to the replacement of faulty parts in an engine. But in many cultures, the movement of organs instead between people bodies has profound implication for identities, since it creates possibility for merging of self through the integration of bodily flesh. The self is completely linked and part of the body, and the body is expressed through the self. There is no such Cartesian split between body and mind. And therefore, organs are not considered as mere mechanical part, but as an extension of the shared bodily substances that characterize family relation. And that is the reason why the donation is mainly between family members. Some example of this, in Japan, incorporating foreign organs into one's body is considered as completely unnatural. And this is the reason why living relative donations are encouraged and considered as natural feeling of warmth among blood relatives, even though they are considered a debt that cannot be repaid, just bearable only if the donor is once mad, as an act of love. In Mexico, lack of available cadaveric organ is explained by the conception that organs exchanged in transplantation are never objectified bodily parts, nor as Wally Havar, but they contain the self of the donor, and they are also always already connected to the self of the recipient through familiar relatedness, as we said before. And finally, the fourth assumption about the commodification of human body. Despite current rhetoric, this is not a new problem. The application of market values to human bodies has a long history in the humanity. Think about slavery, prostitution, human trafficking, for example. So all these cases, adding also transplantation, are usually associated with exploitation of disadvantaged peoples, power inequality, injustice, and poverty. And these problems were made evident also in the organ donation and transplantation field once the immunosuppressant drug cyclosporin was put on the market in the late 1970s. So that it became possible to transplant organs without paying close attention to the immunological matching of donors and recipients. And this has created, in fact, what has been called by some scholars the bioavailability of population of potential donors among those disadvantaged poor people, especially in third world countries. And here again, a couple of examples. This time in India, which is the classic nation country mentioned about the problem of organs trafficking. Even though organ selling was made officially legal in this country in 1994, buying and selling of body parts continues under more clandestine guise. Organ brokers operate more or less openly as middlemen, recruiting desperate, in-debt people, especially in-debt people, becoming organ sellers and retaining much of the profit for themselves. It has become a sort of industry in that country. But also in a Western country like USA, transplantation has become a big business with considerable financial gains for medical centers and professionals, and huge profit for pharmaceutical companies from the medication upon which transplant recipients depend to survive. And even non-profit organ procurement organizations wield a substantial budget in order to recruit eligible donors. USA is a business model of transplant programs which drives constant push to expand the market, both on the side of the offer and of the demand, so the side of eligible donors and the patients accepted for transplantation in order to increase their profit. So to conclude, what we have learned, I hope, during this short conversation, four things, I hope, which can be made for the object of further discussion, if you like. First, that the practice of organ donation and transplantation should be contextualized in the social environment in which it takes place, considering the local culture and society in order to be fully appropriate. Second, that the life course of individual and of their death cannot simply be conceptualized as a finite unit of biological time without considering the social ties and the intergenerational linkages between the living and the dead that are considered part of cultural heritage in many societies. And third, the transfer of human organs cannot be regarded as simply a mechanical set of practices without any emotional, cultural, religious, and symbolic dimension, making a substantial contribution to them. And finally, fourth, commodification of human body is a matter for transplantation, like for previous historical issues of justice and human rights. Thank you very much. I will add some references if you want to deepen these subjects for your own interest.
Thank you, Professor Jarelli, for this interesting webinar and for the different approach given to the transplant. I found it a very intriguing and, if I may say, curious webinar, so thank you very much. I don't know if any of the assistants have any question or want to comment any thought, so please feel free to comment anything that came to your mind.
I am fully available to any question, please.
Yes.
Perfect.
Yes, Dr. Professor Jarelli, I'm Yadira from Transplant Child. Hello, thank you for the excellent presentation. I have, I'm from Colombia, so in our cases is similar to Mexico, and we have a universal donation in Colombia, but we have a problem with organs and everything. But here in Europe, there isn't any difference between countries. For example, Scandinavian countries, East Europe countries, and Mediterranean countries about the culture of or organ transplant donation?
Yeah, thank you for your question. Yes, usually there is a main difference between northern and southern countries. But even the eastern countries have a different tradition. Since, for example, the Orthodox Church traditionally wasn't very much in favor of organ donation and transplantation. Orthodox Church was also and still is against cremation because it considers a sort of destroyment of a body, which is considered as something donated by God and so cannot be destroyed by the human beings. But the main difference is between northern and southern countries, as you were mentioning. Since while in the northern country, the Anglo-Saxon conception, which is at the origins of the organ and transplant practice in Northern America, is the most diffuse concept, especially in the UK, obviously, but also in Scandinavia. There is a difference in Germany, where there is more attention to the idea of living organs, because, as you know, in the past there was the terrible experience of the Nazi concentration camp and of the medical experimentation which took place during the Second World War in those camps. So there is still some fear about the way these organs are treated, and there is a bigger care in order to make their conservation as better as possible. In Mediterranean countries like Italy, Spain, Portugal, and in some way also in Greece, but Greece, as you know, is not a Catholic country. So it is part of the Orthodox Church I mentioned before. In Italy, Spain, and Portugal, where the main tradition, religious tradition, is Catholic, where the popular culture about this problem is in some way closer to the Mexican conception, even though nowadays the role of the family in these countries is no longer as important as it is still in Latin America. The large extended family doesn't exist anymore in Italy, for example. And so the matter of the decision about organ donation, for example, is really becoming, like in the Anglo-Saxon context, only an individual matter and no longer a family matter. And even the idea of living donors, because this can in some way continue the tie, the linkage between different generations, between mother and child, between older and younger people of the same family, is no longer so common as it was in the past, also in these Mediterranean countries. I hope I answered your question.
Yes, thank you, Professor Giarelli.
Not at all.
Okay, if there is no more question, we think we can finish this webinar. So we really appreciate your collaboration, Dr. Giarelli. And thank you very much for this webinar. I found it, as I said before, very interesting. So thank you very much.
Bye-bye to everybody. Bye. Thank you to you.